Hey everybody, this is Christian Buckley with another post-TweetJam, Collab Talk TweetJam, post-TweetJam interview. Adam, hello.
Hey, how's it going, Christian?
And thanks so much for participating. It's always interesting. You get a lot of people that like sign on, yes, I want to participate. And other people like, I just don't know if I can make it. And then it's like the day of, we do this 1 hour online event and the conversation, and there's half the people that said they would be there aren't. Stuff happens, you know?
Yeah.
And then all these other people that either didn't respond or weren't sure, they show up. But every time, I mean, I get so much out of the dialogue that flies by on Twitter. It's just
Absolutely.
A great resource for content. Well, why don't you introduce yourself, who you are, where you are, what you do?
Yeah, sure. Adam Ball, based out of the Denver area, co-founder of a few things. I feel like co-founder of Cloud Revolution is the day job, co-founder of ComsV Next, the community-driven Microsoft Teams UC conference happens here in Denver as well, and then also co-founder of the Colorado UC User Group. Have been doing that for actually 10 years now, so I'm super proud of that, and it's great to be here. Just like you said, Christian, I get so much out of these sweet jams. I see so much, and I get so many different viewpoints of things. I know we'll talk about it here in a few minutes, but I love the different mindset changes that I get out of the tweet jams.
Well, it's interesting too in this topic. So the topic was staying productive in a multi-tenant, multi-cloud world. I mean, just in the title there, you really have two very different areas. And
yep.
You had people that were participating that were very much about the front end, individual, personal, or team productivity, like that focus, that world. So the Microsoft 365 and productivity suite. And then you have more of the partner-centric, organization-centric, infrastructure-centric, multi-cloud discussion, that side of it. And I intentionally wanted to like talk about this broad topic because it would go in different directions.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually a couple of things that came up to me because like you said, I kind of came at it from that B2B world, right? And somebody, I don't even know who it was, brought up the point where it's like, hey, well, you also have acquisitions and things. So you have multi-tenant in an acquisition world.
Yeah.
And it kind of made me pause and reevaluate some of my answers even. So another good example of that mindset change.
Well, we'll get into it in some of these. And we have the benefit here of talking about this and going through the seven questions that were posted, because it's always seven questions. It just happens to be the magic number for that 1 hour to kind of keep things going. But we also then can kind of add in, as if they were our original thoughts, what others may have stated.
That's I'm going to take that one. It's me now.
Well, so we started off, the first question was, what was the primary productivity issues end users and you personally experience when working across multiple tenants and or multiple cloud environments?
Yeah. And for me, this one is all about identity, right? So having to jump from identity to identity, even if it's in guest access. So I go from my tenant to somebody else's tenant and the issue is that it makes me pause, right? Which maybe is a good thing. Maybe we all need to take a breath, have a sip of coffee or what have you. But when you change, it disrupts the workflow, right? Like having to go, oh, I'm not in that tenant. And, you know, it's funny it might only take you a few seconds, but it takes you out of that world and then takes you into a new world, and your thought process is broken. You have to regain that thought control of what you're trying to accomplish, and then you have to get back to that other process. And so that, for me, that identity process is the piece that's the biggest productivity.
Well, that's blocker. One of the reasons why. I mean, it doesn't solve it because caused other concerns, but of like Microsoft Teams being so powerful in that it, you know, is bringing where a lot of that multitasking or the separation of the conversation from the work activities, and where Teams brought those things together. So you could have a contextual conversation about this thing, this document that we're working on together, this profile, this website, this dashboard that we're both reviewing and talking through at the same time. Having it all in one place. Now, then the problem, as you brought up, is Teams is a great example of this. This actually, when Teams launched, and this is really where you and I got to know each other, was because so many of the unified communication crowd that were Skype people and really that UC, the telephony world, which is just a very different world. Yeah. I worked in telecom for the first third of my careers. Like I understand a lot of that. All came over into Teams. that part of things moved over. And so we got to know each other. So you and Jonathan McKinney and mm-hmm. some great conversations. But suddenly people knew that we're getting now invited into dozens now, you know, could be hundreds for some people of teams and channels. And there's just this constant flurry of notifications. And like I commented, I hear a ding somewhere in my desktop. Like, what was that? Which application, which thing do I have open where that's alerting me? Yeah. Or is it my phone? Or, now is it my watch, you know?
Or is it a browser tab? Yeah, exactly.
Right. And that's the biggest frustration is organizing the notifications and organizing, keeping those things streamlined. And I find like I'm continuously going in, pinning and unpinning in Teams, in browsers. I have, pinned and favorites bars and all these things that I use. There's kind of a science that I follow behind that to stay organized.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. You have to. I mean, especially, and it's harder because for us, right, we are in a much more B2B world. And so I might interact with 10 different customers or organizations. And so that really helps drive some of those productivity issues for me. If I was just a knowledge worker inside an organization, like maybe I wouldn't have some of those issues, but I don't think I'm that uncommon as far as that goes. I think I think other people can relate to what the challenges I face.
Well, I think early on with some of the feedback, so my personal experience in providing this feedback, this guidance back to Microsoft saying, hey, I think the multi-tenancy issues are getting, like multi-cloud is a different conversation. We're going to get into more of that. Yep. The multi-tenancy issue, and Microsoft just kind of said, yeah, that's like but you're an MVP or you're a consultant. Yep. It's different. I'm like, it's not though.
Because your sales are marketing.
Right.
Sales and marketing is constantly interacting with other companies and they're right there in that same spot. Right. So I agree. I don't think there's that much difference there.
Well, question two kind of built off of that. Somebody commented, it's like, wow, you really went dark with the first question, and I commented, I said, like, I understand how the social networks work is that rage equals engagement. So I get hooked people into the conversation. So question two is, what are your biggest successes? So really what works well when working across multiple tenants and or multiple cloud environments?
Yeah. So I said this in the tweet jam. I don't necessarily know that this is the right thing, but it's what works for me. I end up having multiple browser profiles so that I can have them all up. So even if I'm in a guest tenant, right? So here I am in my home tenant, I will actually open my home tenant in a browser profile so I can then change between guest access without having to change my Teams desktop client. And again, Teams is a great example of where multi-tenant falls down in an application really quickly, because I'll point out Outlook has this, right? I can add all my Outlook accounts and I can interact with those really easily.
Or the Teams mobile app. Yeah, the mobile app.
The mobile app is fantastic for it. And so the desktop is the problem child right now. And I know that Microsoft has talked for a while now that they're planning to fix that. So I look forward to the day when that comes about. But like I said, it may not be the right way to do it, but that's the way I solve that problem very effectively for me so that I can be in all the different tenants. Because I have to be in the comms VNext tenant, right? Because we're constantly, our event's coming up here soon in a few days. When I have to be paying attention to that, because there might be something that comes up that needs immediate attention. If I had to go sign out of my Teams client and sign in over there, it's just not productive.
Well, I think that it's improved with some of the Outlook integration around the notifications. Again, if you're talking about in the Microsoft, 365 stack and your solutions, and there are options. The most common being is just as you said, different browser profiles. And I use another, I do that, but I also use Rambox. So I have multiple applications there, and that does a decent job with notifications across the top. But it's like having, it's just another resource intensive application. If you have Chrome open and Rambox and Teams, then, your video quality will be crap of doing just a one-on-one chat. Yeah. But there's that. one of the other things, like I kept talking about, it's like, oh, I want like a mobile emulator. It's like, well, there are tools that are out there, paid and free, where you can basically have a Bluetooth or a wired connection of your mobile device, you know, whether iPhone or Android, on your desktop, and then just have the Teams app up all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I haven't done that, but that's an interesting thought. I don't know if that would work really well for me on the day-to-day because of trying to pull up documents and stuff like that. But for chat and collab, absolutely, that would work really well.
You know, I'm not sure how that works. I've not gone experimented, because it was the app I was looking at, it was paid to be able to enable the desktop clicking. I could view it on screen, but I'd still have to do the controls via my device. But just the paid version allows you to do either way. And what actually happens if I click on it, does that open up naturally in the browser? Like I've got to go test that out, but
yeah, I'll look forward to hearing your thoughts on it.
I'm going to go experiment. It's on the list of things to do, to write about.
The never ending list.
Of course. So the third question is, how does the rapid rate of innovation, so updates, the changes, so much that's happening, impact your personal and organizational productivity on multi-tenant and multi-cloud environments?
Yeah, it's something I want to comment on real quick before we get in here, because multi-tenant is super easy to focus in on. Multi-cloud to me meant something completely different than I think what you might have intended, right? When I think about multi-cloud, I think about, you know, where is my service living, right? Yep. So is it Azure? Is it, you know, somebody else's cloud? Is it?
We can say the names here. No, yeah, that's exactly what I meant. Yeah, Amazon, Google, you know, IBM, whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know,
Salesforce. Yeah. And that's not necessarily my world. So I'll end up staying a little bit more focused on that multi-tenant side of things, but wanted to call that out. But in both cases, I think the rapid rate of innovation creates one specific pain point, which is user adoption and user education around it. Because if I don't know what's going on, and all of a sudden something changes, and it happens so frequently, where it's like, what I was doing yesterday worked, and now what I'm doing doesn't work. Why not? And it just leads to that frustration of, am I going crazy? Am I going, you know, and don't answer that question, because the answer is probably yes at the end of the day. But I think that's the biggest thing for user frustration, right? Like they're already frustrated because they can't get their job done. And now you throw rapid change into it, and it's just adding to that stress level for the average worker.
You know, one thing it has made people, I know certainly, you know, with some of the problems, again, going back to in Teams, because I know that, you know, it's the kind of the central hub that you and I both work from, but you know, you can apply this to any enterprise application that's like that, where there's rapid change. But I've become more familiar with some of the behaviors of the application of the platform to when change is happening. Like if I know, for example, Teams is something where I host, I have regular calls, and occasionally I'll go in and record. Like I go to hit record, and sometimes it'll say record, you know, record to turn it on. It'll be grayed out.
Yeah.
My meeting, nothing's changed. I'm in the right tenant, kind of all the things that you go through in your mind. Like why am I logged in as a guest tenant somewhere that I think set up differently? Other times, like it's missing entirely. What I've learned from that is like, all right, there's a partially deployed system update. There's something that's impacted our tenant around that. And I know just to come back a couple hours later, it'll be in place.
Right. There's, and that's exactly it. But the end user doesn't care about that. Right. Like as an end user, I don't care. I just need it to work now. But the one thing I will say is this, that it's a double-edged sword. So I want to call that out in the fact that while you have that frustration, having worked in this OCS link Skype days where you had to wait 6 months for a feature to come, right? I get a lot more self-satisfaction when that feature shows up in 2 weeks instead of 6 months. And so you got to take the good with the bad in that of that. But and I made this comment, I feel like the message center is like, you know, when, you know, if we go to IKEA and you open up the box, it's like, I don't need the instructions. Nobody reads the message center. I love that Microsoft gives us the message center. Thank you. But nobody reads it at the end of the day. I know I'll probably get a lot of comments saying, I read it.
People that do.
Yeah, exactly. But at the same point in time, you know, we publish the message center updates right into our own Teams channel to try to bring awareness to that so that people know, hey, this changed. But again, people just don't. It's like asking a man asking for directions. It just doesn't happen. So,
you know, so it's in this, my best practice for that is that I see the messages, I get the alerts out there. I triage them and I look at the ones that there's the ones that are obvious, like don't know what that is. Don't care. You know, delete kind of those messages. And then other ones where like, hey, I need to look at this later, or those that I'll read, but I do make sure that I scan through those.
Yeah.
And then of course I also, I'm a big fan of like Daryl Webster and Daniel Glenn and the message center updates that they do.
Yep.
Answer regarding 365 group. Yep. And so kind of see if there's something miss, you know, did I miss something? And as the last couple months, like I've been on top of it, like I see their video come out a day or two later and I'm like, yeah, I already know.
Yeah.
Covering.
My only other issue on that, on the message center is, and I know Lauren Strant has made this comment too, is that you get email blasted as an admin consistently about major changes, and you look at it and you're like, how many users are actually using that got blasted out as a major change? And so there's this balance between alerting and noise. Right. And so I think Microsoft can do a little bit better job there, just a little bit. And that would help a lot with getting people to pay more attention to the message center.
I think there was the talk about, do we send this out as a digest and let people kind of expand out on those versus the one-offs around each one of those things? And it's great to complain about this kind of stuff now. Let's go 2-3 years back in the past when we didn't have this stuff. This is fantastic. So I'd rather be inundated with information and then have to go through that filtering mechanism than not have the info.
Absolutely. I think, like I said, it's that double-edged sword. So with the feature aspects.
So question number four was, what are the greatest governance concerns with multi-tenant and multi-cloud environments?
Oh, we don't have enough time for this, but the bottom line is the data, right? Who controls it is really the biggest concern there, because if, and I use this metaphor with customers all the time, it's like your kids, right? So you can either invite people in and like you tell your kids, bring your friends over, and you have control and you know what's happening with your kids in the basement. You kind of know what's going on, or you can say, hey, I don't want you here, and your kids go out and they're going to do something somewhere else, right? And the data is the same way. Do I want the data in my tenant, and do I want the data and where I can control it? Or do you want people going out and taking that data elsewhere where you now have no control? So the greatest concerns is who owns the data, who has it? And now if that data is in your tenant, how do I get my controls onto the data that's over there?
Right. And this is that's a good segue into the next question, which was, you know, how important are interoperability and data portability to current and future multi-tenant and multi-cloud? And where we start crossing over into the multi-cloud is again around, you know, governance and data management and ownership around those things, is because as we look at from an organizational standpoint, I mean, it's easier when you're talking about, you know, ultimately everything in Microsoft 365, data lives in SharePoint and or Exchange. Like everything that crosses through Teams is in one of those two places. And it even like Stream, everything's getting moved over. So it's all the same, similar back end around that, so that you can better centrally manage and create governance policies and rules around and manage the security, compliance, and risk, all those kinds of things. Exactly. When you're talking about multi-cloud and what that looks like, obviously there's a lot of data that doesn't need to move in between those environments. But that which does, and even if the data's not moving, you still have to be consistent in the rules, the security and compliance and governance rules that you place across data, no matter where it is, and how are you managing that?
Exactly.
If you're making a change in one place, what does that look
like? Well, I think this is actually where that multi-tenant viewpoint changed for me. Somebody made the comment where it's like mergers and acquisitions. All of a sudden, now it's like, to me, that interoperability and just data portability, I want to be able to take that data from that merger and bring that into mine. How do I do that? And I made the comment in all of this, it's the hard part is that we have, there's very little incentive for companies to provide the way out but there's a lot of incentive for them to provide the way in. And I think that's something that any customer should be asking about is what does that look like beyond the data controls? Because there is that constant mergers and acquisition viewpoint.
Well, there was a, we had a little kind of a side conversation happen about migration. I made the comment. Yeah. And everybody, we've all heard this, that said again, that migrations are more of like a one-time project. Like we're moving from a you know, SharePoint 2010 to SharePoint 2019 or SharePoint Online, or we're moving from our data that's in eRoom or out in Box, and we're moving that over to the Microsoft platform, that kind of thing. That's a migration. Yeah. But what we're talking about doing is really the movement of data, that move, which is more of a change management activity. That's how I respond to that. And that's part of it. You're right, because that lock-in, I remember when this transition in the late 90s was happening. I came from the data warehouse world and all the front-end applications on that, where you had vendors that made it excruciatingly painful to move off of their platform. So to do what's right for for your users, you know, that you need to make sure that you have the latest, greatest features and functionality that's out there. And yet you could often find yourself locked into this platform with less desirable options.
Yeah. And I don't think anybody's doing it nefariously today. So I don't think there's like this intentional aspect. It's just incentive, right? I need to get people on board to my platform. So I'll make it really easy. But the way out is more of an afterthought from that standpoint. And that goes to say for even within Microsoft. So if I have tenant A and tenant B and we're merging companies, trying to get data out of tenant A into tenant B is difficult just because, again, it's not the focus right now.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, moving the data is a heck of a lot easier than everything else that moves along with that. So you're... you know, information architecture and the taxonomy that you've built things out, like all of that, the rest of that, which gets very messy very quickly. But that's, I made the comment that, I think in the future, organizations need to be really good at change management.
Yes.
And if, you know, those that I tweeted out something, I got a bunch of likes on it. It might be the most liked tweet from the Tweet Jam, but I said something to the effect of, you know, organizations that make—I need to find the tweet—but that make change management a priority or a skill will out innovate their competitors.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's becoming more and more, and I actually think this ties into item six, to question six for you, is the fact that, you know, as the IT pro role changing, those IT pros who can adapt into that change management role or kind of take that business mindset to help the business improve and say, hey, I don't have to deal with the commodity aspects. To me, that's the role change that needs to happen more so than anything else. I don't know how well that's happening. I still see a lot of people who are stuck and are resistant, but I think those are the changes that I would see if somebody was asking me, I'm an IT pro, what should I be doing? I'd be pushing them towards that.
You know, it's interesting, back when, you remember when TechEd was rebranded as Ignite, and so it was the Chicago event, and I did a session where I did a bunch of research, so I was invited to present. So here I was, a non-IT pro, I'm essentially a marketing guy, but I went, I've done, marketing research for a number of clients and things and independently, but I did this research on, and polled the community and did this presentation. There are probably 1500 people in my session talking about the future state, like what's happening to the IT pro role.
Yeah.
And that was the primary, feedback. There was a lot of concern from people, but the primary guidance that came from Microsoft executives and other just IT executives, out in the field, that it was changing, but it was even more imperative that companies didn't just go cut, that they held on to the people that had the platform knowledge and that these other vendors' solution specific things, that there became more of a, almost a business analyst function to their roles. They're more deeply involved, not just pure technology, but they had to better understand the business, but that they are some of the most needed roles within an organization. That's still the traditional IT pro role.
Absolutely. I do think that, I like how you term that, the business analyst, because IT knows, they're right up there. Like, so coming from the telephony world, the admin assistants have so much control because they're lockstep with their executives. The IT is pro is the same for the business. They know all the ins and outs. They know where a system was duct taped together to make something happen, and they know how the system is supposed to flow. They can be keys to how does the business increase productivity and process, because they know where the bodies are hidden on that. So
yeah, I was going to use the same phrasing, but better yeah. than you than me. Yeah. So for the last question, I know we got just a couple of minutes here. Says what three things can or should organizations do to optimize their multi-tenant, multi-cloud environments?
My first one that I came up with on this was define why. Define the why for why multi-tenant, multi-cloud, very specifically. I hear all different reasons for all that, but make sure you know your why. There's no judgment, and so just got to know it. Second thing is invest in that training and user education. I liked a couple of people. I just kind of simplified it, but I liked the way a couple of people said it was people need to know where to do things and why to do it over there. So which spot, and then. Topic that we've talked a lot about is be ready for that change management, that constant communication out. Those were my three things.
No, I think that's a great wrap up. And you start with essentially, I'd simplify it in one word, is a plan.
Yeah.
Have a plan for this. Across all of this, it really is like, you need to understand what the core platforms provide and what the outcomes that you're trying to deliver for your organization. And just knowing that, like understanding what they're capable of, and what your organization needs out of that. And then the rest of it, then you build the plan out of what's the gap in between those. Like exactly. It's limited features, there'll be products, the services that are out there, no matter how complex it looks, they either do or they don't do certain things. You need them or you don't need those things. And so you have to fill those gaps, develop your plan, develop your overall strategy for that. How much you're integrating, how much you're building, what you can go and buy, what third-party services that you need to provide around that. Yep. It gets a bit hairy when you start talking about multi-cloud. And again, could be very dramatically different applications, but your end users, ultimately, that's why I think the tie-in on productivity is your end users don't care whether you're going to Microsoft for one set of solutions, to Amazon for another, to Salesforce for another around that. All they know is that their operating system, the environments, when they log into your, whatever the primary platform, primary platform is, that it's consistent, that it makes sense, that they can get their work done.
Exactly. They need to get their work done. They're there to do their job. That's all they want to do. They want to get in, they want to be able to do their job, and then they want to be able to go do whatever else it is that they want to do. They don't want to have to spend time thinking about what they need to be doing. So.
Well, excellent. Well, Adam, I know that we're at time here. Thanks so much for giving us your takeaways on today's TweetJam, and thanks for participating.
Oh, absolutely. I always look forward to it, and we'll look forward to next month as well.